Monastrevin is named for the monastery of St. Evan, Monasterevin, but it was Evan's mentor, a prolific founder of monastic settlements, St. Abban, who first raised a monastery here and gifted it to Evan. Evan was the prince of the Eonach sect of Cashel in Munster, and came with a coterie of monks from his native land and settled the area where the River Barrow and the Black River join together. We're going to start our walk around the town at the top of Drogheda Street, in front of the imposing Catholic Church of Saints Peter and Paul. Designed by William Dean Butler, construction started in 1845 and was completed in 1847 at the height of the Great Famine. Being just a day's travel from Dublin and having a considerable industrial merchant wealth, the famine touched lightly on the parish. Through the trees to the right we can see Toker House, the mansion of James Cassidy, the Catholic distilling magnate, which was built in 1870. Moving to the right towards Ballykelly, we can see the fine stonework of the old railway station. The railway reached Monastrevin in 1846. The very first train to leave the station and cross the River Barrow had a local driver, Jack Bryan, better known as Hellfire Jack, because as he drove the first train out of Monastrevin and over the new metal bridge, he was heard to call out, "Now, for hell or for Limerick." Turning left, we can walk along the edge of the canal harbour basin. In earlier days, barges and flyboats traversed this stretch of water, which is the Barrow branch of the Grand Canal. Turning left, we can walk along the edge of the canal harbour basin, which is the Barrow branch of the Grand Canal. The canal arrived here in 1786, dug by the inland navigators, or navvies. The harbour had extensive warehouses along the docks. In addition to cargo barges, there were fast passenger services called flyboats, three of which arrived from Dublin every day. The captains of the flyboats relied on a reputation of speed and comfort and a well-stocked bar and board to attract passengers who would otherwise have to endure the slower stagecoach over potholed roads. If we follow the towpath past the Swan's Nest, we come to the drawbridge that carries the road over the canal. The original structure was a bascule lifting bridge that was raised to let the canal boats pass from the harbour towards the aqueduct, which was built in 1826 to replace a series of locks that took the canal down one bank of the Barrow River and up the other side, where the canal branched in two, one line going to Mount Melick and the other to Athy, where the Grand Canal entered the Barrow River navigation. Standing here high above the river, we have a perfect view to understand why Monastrevin is called the Venice of Ireland. From this point, we can count 16 bridges within the boundaries of the town. If we look upriver, we can see the railway bridge and beyond the medieval pass bridge over which the Earl of Essex marched in Elizabethan times. If we retrace our steps off the aqueduct and turn right, we pass over Moore's Bridge. The wide street ahead is called West End and gives a good idea of the amount of wealth the canal brought to the town. The buildings are a terrace of impressive three-storey Georgian merchants' houses with their characteristic fanlights and sash windows. Moving on, we pass the junction of Whelan's Row and Main Street. Whelan's Row was named for a local man who was a gunner in the Royal Navy at the time of Nelson's victory at Trafalgar. Gunnar Whelan used his prize money to buy property each time he returned from the sea and eventually owned a terrace of houses on this street and gave his name to it. If we pause here a moment, we can look down along Main Street and its unique characteristics will become obvious. Monastrevin is a planned town. Its development was directed by the local landlord, Charles Moore, 1st Marquess of Drogheda, in the second half of the 18th century. He laid the town out as two long parallel streets, Drogheda Street and Main Street, connected by a number of crossing streets. The result was that the houses on Main Street unusually have their front gardens across the road on the riverbank. This made it both straight and very wide enough for a regiment of cavalry to parade down. This was necessary because the Marquess of Drogheda was colonel of the 18th Hussars, a famous regiment of the British Army that originally counted many Monastrevin men among its ranks. Monastrevin also had its own yeoman cavalry and yeoman infantry. Both these units are associated with the large white Georgian-style mansion halfway down Main Street. Originally, Monastrevin House was the home of Reverend Walter Bagot, Church of Ireland rector. His brother John was captain of the Monastrevin Yeoman Infantry, a and the house was a focal point for the Loyalists of the area in 1798. By 1854, however, the upwardly mobile Cassidy family, whiskey distillers and landlords, had bought the house. By the 1880s, two of the spinster Cassidy sisters, Mary and Frances Ann, lived here, with a third sister, Mrs. Eleanor Weeble, being a regular visitor. Mrs. Weeble was responsible for inviting the poet Gerald Manley Hopkins to holiday in Munstrevin. Between 1886 and 1889, he visited what he came to see as a peaceful retreat six times and wrote of the river that flowed outside his window as the Burbling Barrow Brown. Further down the street is St. John's Church of Ireland. Inside, a striking feature is the large, ornate private pew belonging to the Earl of Drogheda, who caused the church to be built here to replace an earlier one. In the extensive churchyard are the tombs of the Earls of Drogheda and several Commonwealth war graves. That point, known as the Slip, can be found five or six strides across the road at the back of the fire station. On the wall of the station is a small plaque marking this as the site of the Battle of Munstrevin. In the dawn hours of the 25th of May 1798, three columns of United Irish rebels converged on the town of Munstrevin. The street was filled with the crash and smoke of musket fire, but the rebels pressed on, only to be surprised by the charge of the Munstrevin yeoman cavalry. The rebels were routed, and as the smoke cleared, five yeomen, 63 rebels and nine horses lay dead in the street here in front of us. The Lyle Bastion of Munstrevin was one of the only towns in the county to repel the rebels. So began a long hot summer of terror that leads us to the monument in Market Square. The fine Celtic cross that was raised in 1899 by the Nationalists of Munstrevin commemorates the events. The curate of the parish, Father Edward Prendergast, went into the camp at Barn Hill to administer the last rites to the sick and wounded. His presence there was observed and reported. At that time, the head of the Irish Secret Service, Lord Tyrawley, was staying at Moorabbey House and directed that the hanging of a priest would make a good example to subdue the population. The monument bears the inscription, all are gone, but still lives on the fame of those who died, when true men, like you men, remember them with pride. Now, crossing Dublin Street at the traffic lights, we can go through the gates of Moorabbey, the seat of the Earls of Drogheda. Down the shady tree-lined driveway, you'll often smell the pungent wild garlic growing along the banks of the River Barrow. Rounding the final curve, we come to Moorabbey House, a fine mansion built in the strawberry Gothic style. Originally, this was the site of a Cistercian monastery of Rossglass, founded in 1189. Two great towers of the church rose from where the west wing of Moorabbey House now stands, high enough to be seen clearly from the round tower in Kildare. The monastery was under the patronage of the O'Dempseys of Clanmalear across the river in Laois, and the monks farmed the land and offered prayers for their salvation. After Henry VIII's dissolution of the Irish monasteries, the lands eventually passed to the Moore family, who were titled Earls of Drogheda. Charles Moore was 6th Earl and 1st Marquess of Drogheda. He made extensive alterations to the property, creating the building we see today. The 3rd Marquess started the race meeting at Punchestown, which is such a fixture of Kildare's racing calendar. He was also the founder of the Drogheda Memorial Hospital on the Curragh, better known as the Jockey Hospital. We leave the peaceful grounds of Moorabbey and return to the traffic on Dublin Street and the massive industrial complex that was Cassidy's Distillery. Originally founded by John Goslin around 1700, it was taken over by John Cassidy in 1784. At the height of its operations, it employed 70 skill workers and 30 dray horses and produced an amazing 200,000 gallons of whiskey, the vast majority of which was for domestic consumption, but 50,000 gallons were exported to the USA. As we cross the road again, we can see a similar range of buildings. This was another Cassidy concern, a brewery where St. Patrick's Pale Ale was produced for the Dublin market. All distilling and brewing ceased here in 1920 after the death of Robert Cassidy. As we turn the corner, we leave Dublin Street and re-enter Drogheda Street. This wide, tree-lined avenue runs parallel to Main Street. The trees themselves are horse chestnuts planted by the Reverend Moore, a cousin of the Marquess of Drogheda. Here we find another waterway within our town. Cassius Stream, or the Mill Stream, which once provided cooling and power to the distillery. It flows alongside Drogheda Row, which opens into the Rattangan Road, And as we follow this, we come to St. Evan's Park. On the morning of the 21st of October 1975, this housing estate became the focus of a two-week hostage situation. The kidnapped Dutch industrialist, T. de Herme, was held here by the Provisional IRA in number 1410. Armoured cars and international media surrounded the park and caused a great stir in the town. If we continue along the Rattangan Road, we pass under the railway and come to Ball Alley Cross, once the site of one of Kildare's many handball alleys that were meeting places of the United Irishmen in the 1790s. We then find ourselves back on the Ballykelly Road. A turn to the right would take us to the old Minchnorton Mills, which are currently being converted into a distillery so that Munnistreven whisky will soon flow again. We'll turn left, and keeping the Grand Canal on our right, we'll pass under the railway line again and find ourselves back with the Swans and Ducks in Canal Harbour.